What up, YouTube? It's time to brew some beer. Today, I'm doing an experiment. I got two of the exact same brews, and I want to answer a question. Does it make a difference to stir the mash up and let the grain bed reset? Or if I just run off the first run and then fill it back up and then run off the second run? I like this one because it's a simple recipe, and because I'm doing two batches the same day real quick, just to see if there's any difference between one technique that I'm doing, it minimizes the amount of variables. First batch I'll be doing will be the control batch. That'll be doing this just exactly like I normally do. Second batch is gonna be my experiment. I'm gonna do the same brew. The only difference is instead of stirring in between batches, I'm gonna do the first runoff, fill it back up, and then just immediately do the second runoff. I'm gonna be checking everything on this one. The mash efficiency, the overall brew house efficiency, the clarity of the beer, just out of curiosity, and also the taste and the flavor. The main thing I wanna see is the efficiency. Am I wasting time filling it up, stirring, letting it reset, and does it matter? You guys watched the overview video I did about the plumbing that I got set up here. I could fill from here and also from the bottom when I'm filling up, which is nice. It just makes this go a little bit faster. It's also useful in the event that you would ever have a stuck sparge. There's 3.3, there it is, 3.2. Not that any of us have ever experienced a stuck sparge. No, no, never, never. All right, let's mash in. When I started doing this, I remember thinking, oh geez, I mean, it's a 5 gallon keg. Why would I ever need to do a bigger than a 5 gallon batch? I see all these people creating home brews that create 10 gallon batches. And I thought, that's overkill for a home brew. Then I got the bar set up and 3 kegs and 3 taps and had a party or two and realized 5 gallons of home brew is not that much once you start making good home brew and invite a couple of friends over. Sparge arm. All right, so you guys hear the alarm there. That means that my mash is complete. So now I'm gonna start my mash out. Bring my water up to 170. All right, 170 is locked in. So we're gonna heat up that Herm's coal, get that thing prepped, and then we'll do our first run. I'm also gonna pull a sample, check my pH on my mash. Just because I have not been doing that and I'm curious. Time to start our first run. I'm gonna do as scientific as possible, so I'm gonna use this screwdriver. To set the spacing on this valve. The rate of your runoff does impact your efficiency. That's an experiment for a different day. But for today, I want to keep everything the same with the exception of whether or not I stir the mash in between runoffs. I'm going to do the exact same thing both times. First run is complete. The way I normally do this, I open the bottom valve all the way again and it allows me to push water in from both sides. I'm going to bring my hot water down to 5.25. That'll give me the 3.75 gallons that I'm looking for. There it is. Now we go back into recert. Do what I normally do, which is give my mash a good disruptive stir. As I'm doing this, I just realized there's always variables, but here another variable that I wasn't thinking about. This is a fairly simple grain bill. It's only 8 pounds, well, 8.75. Or I wonder if the variable will, this stir versus no stir, will make a difference based on how many pounds of grains you have. Now technically it shouldn't. I wouldn't think it would because your water to weight ratio is still the same. I got some clogs in this here. There's our stir. So now I'm gonna let this recirculate for 15 minutes to set the grain bed, and then we'll do our final runoff. And at this time, I also kick on the heating element for my boil. And if Beer Smith was on point, we should be running out of water. Nice thing about switching over early, our boil is already at 188. So we are close to hitting boil starting our boil already as we finish up this run. Oh, there we go. Just at 5.7. I like it when the math works out. We'll let this cool. And then we'll take a gravity reading. Set this up for the recirc. This is in. Nice thing is, this is a super simple recipe, like I said. Two hop additions. And out. Here comes the boil. They say a watched pot never boils. I've found in brewing, an unwatched pot boils over. And with the bittering hops. This is the HBU packets that they've been putting out at American Homebrew. It's actually pretty smart when you look at it. Bittering hops, as I've been told, bittering hops pretty much don't matter which hops you use for bittering. Flavoring hops are a different thing. So what I was normally doing was I would use my hops, extra hops from other recipes as bittering hops to save a little bit of money rather than buying, you know, brand new hops and letting hops go bad. But with this system, they're creating bittering hops that are just what they can make on the cheap, knowing that the flavor isn't really what you're looking for. You're just looking for the proper acids for the bittering. First batch came in the pre-boil gravity 1.042. So we'll see how that compares to the pre-boil gravity of our Noster. I'm gonna go ahead and dump my grains, clean this out. I've already got my water prepped for batch two, so as soon as I kill the flame on this, start heating up the water on that. 3, 2, 1. That is it. Got our whirlpool pump going, immersion chillers going, and I've switched over the hot water to start heating up my second batch. Batch number two. I wasn't going to, but actually I am going to put the grain bill up there. All the ingredients. Even though I buy this as a kit, if one of you guys decides you want to do this and you don't actually want to buy the kit, you'll have all the ingredients you need, so you can just duplicate it yourself. With it being a clone recipe, I know there's going to be some people out there who want to duplicate this. We're mashing. I'm only gonna bring this up to 8. I'm gonna bring this up to 8 gallons. That should cool me down to 152, and it also gives me a good starting point for the water measured whenever I do the second run. It'll take a little bit less time to get it up to the 170 mash out as well. 8 gallons literally goes right over the top of my coil. We're mashing the second batch, and we are ready to get the first batch into the fermenter. Estimated starting gravity was 1.046. I hit 1.052. That makes sense based on the differences of the volume because, you know, one, my system's usually pretty good at mash efficiency, and two, I'm down like a gallon basically from where I normally am on my batches. If I was just doing this for beer, I would plus it up to hit the 5.25 going into the fermenter. Because I know with the trub loss and the yeast and all that kind of stuff, it ends me with a 5 gallon batch. I'm expecting both of these batches to be light, probably somewhere around 4 gallons. But what I want to do is I don't want to make any other variables within this, so I'm going to keep everything streamlined the same. We're going to see if I end up with the same exact boil off and all that kind of stuff using this method. So cool, we're at 170. Now, instead of doing my normal run, batch, sparge, stir, sit, I'm going to run it, batch it, run it again. So now it's time for the switch up. Luckily, this is all gonna be cookie cutter since we just did this. And there we go, we're running. Everything's gonna be exactly as it was before. On this first step in the experiment, I will be curious to see if the runoff is any clearer since I won't be disturbing it by stirring it. And when I add the water, I'm only gonna add it from the arm. I'm not gonna come up from the bottom so I don't disturb the grain bread at all. And we are right at 2 gallons, which is exactly where we were the first time. This is gonna take a little bit longer because we're only coming in from the top. But that's part of the experiment. Again, what I'm hoping here is that just like the first time, once I get down to 5.2 and I do the remaining runoff, it runs out at the exact same spot, because that would mean that everything is pretty much duplicate in this experiment from the control to this one. As we know in experimenting, you try and minimize variables. There's always going to be variables, but we try and minimize variables. And it shouldn't have disturbed the grain bread or nothing, because it's just dripping in from the top. There we are. The first thing we notice in our experiment, the flow stopped. I thought that was weird. I cracked this valve a little bit, and then I put it back to the same gap to get it flowing again. But I wonder why I did that. Guess it's from the cake on the bottom, but it's, you know, it's flowing again now, just fine. That's interesting. You wouldn't think that, you would think honestly that stirring it and then letting it reset the grain bed would be a higher chance that it would change the flow than leaving it be. But maybe it's because it compacts itself a little bit on the first run, when all the fluid's out. And it stopped at exactly the same point. Everything same as batch number one. Second batch is in the fermenter. My starting gravity of the first one was 1.042, but that was before the temperature correction. It actually was 1.048 after the temperature correction. I just got those numbers switched up in my head. So where we're at as of now, everything's the same. The volumes came out the same between the two batches. The end of the fermenter, they both ended up at 4.5 gallons in the fermenter, and both of them ended up at the same starting gravity, correction, at the same pre-boil gravity. 1.048 is where they both were going into the boil. I'm assuming it's gonna be the same starting gravity with the second batch once it cools and I take the reading before I actually pitch the yeast, because same volume, same everything else, I don't see any reason why it would be any different with the same boil and everything like that. With this being an electric system, everything's equal. You know, I'm doing the same exact temperature on the coil, the same exact fire rate, all that kind of stuff. So I'm not surprised the volumes turned out exactly the same. So far, I am surprised that there was absolutely no difference in the specific gravity between the stirring and the non-stirring. I'm gonna pitch the yeast in each one of these. I'm gonna let them ferment. I'm gonna continue this experiment and see if there's any actual differences between the two techniques. Like most great scientists before me, I made a mistake. On batch one, I had measured my post-boil gravity, and I brought it out at 1.042, but I forgot to adjust for the temperature. On the second one, it came in at 1.042, but I adjusted for temperature, which makes it 1.048. Problem is, I'm not exactly sure what the temperature was on number one when I actually measured the gravity. Everything else in this experiment stayed the same. The volumes on both of these, once they cooled, actually is 4.25. Pre-boil, post-boil, and end of the fermenter are exactly the same. So I would have to make the super duper scientific assumption that the gravity was the same. Now, my final starting gravity into the fermenter of batch number one, that's the stir batch, is 1.052. And on the non-stir is 1.055. That is a very, very minor difference, but the bottom line is, now I gotta think, okay, so this is 1.4, so I gotta go to 7. There's two possibilities with this coming in at one slightly higher starting gravity. Either there's no difference between the stir and the non-stir when it comes to the efficiency and the gravity, or you actually get a slight increase in gravity if you don't stir. Either way, as of now, my experiment is telling me I don't want to stir anymore. I don't need to. I could save the time. It's not increasing my efficiency, and it may actually be negatively impacting my efficiency, and it's saving me time to not stir. Because what I'll be able to do is, instead of stirring, resetting the bed, and then running off again, I can actually start filling and then start the runoff at the same time once I get a little bit of water on top of the grain bed. All that's left is how they ferment out. And if there's any difference in the clarity of the final product or the taste. Don't think there's going to be any difference in the taste. We'll see if there's any difference in the clarity. Here we are, ladies and gentlemen, the conclusion of my stir versus no stir experiment. The final product here, well, it's not actually the complete final product because I still need to carbonate. Stir, no stir. Stir, no stir. Stir, no stir. Basically, it's the same beer. Yep. The conclusion of this, both of these batches turned out exactly the same. Same flavor, same clarity, same color, same brew house efficiency, same mash efficiency. Everything turned out the same. So I can conclude, with this being the same recipe between the two of them, that at least for my brew house system, and go ahead and hit me up in the comments if you guys have experienced something different or if I'm missing something big. Not the end all know all of everything brew house, but for my system, there is no benefit to me stirring the mash versus just doing two runs back to back. The big advantage for me is going to be time saving. One caveat to my system that I didn't actually think all the way through until I was doing this experiment, I probably wouldn't have seen a difference in efficiency because of my recirculation system and because I am really sparging the entire time. Hindsight being 2020, I could have predicted that it wouldn't make a difference based on how long I'm recycling the wort anyway to try and get as much sugars out of the grain bed. But it is fun to do these experiments. I'll probably do some more in the future now that I have an electric system where I can really lock in all the values and make sure that the only variable that I'm changing is the variable that I'm trying to experiment on. And it never hurts to have two batches of the same beer if they turned out well. Here it is once again for your viewing pleasure, Big Wave Golden Ale clone recipes. Both of them turned out with the same final gravity. Both of them fermented out in the same amount of time. There were no differences between stirring and non-stirring. So for now on, I will not be stirring. Take a minute to like and subscribe. I know that I don't ask you guys to do that a lot, but it really does help with the YouTube algorithm. It bumps me up and gives me more motivation to keep making these types of videos, which I enjoy. And let me know in the comments anything that was useful or anything that I missed in this experiment. And as always, keep brewing.